Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Brigitte Rose, and on behalf of Lung Foundation Australia, welcome to the final event in our 2020 Live Well, Breathe Better patient webinar series. This session is proudly supported by Janssen Australia and New Zealand. I can see we have a few people coming into the session live today, so thank you so much for being here. It's great to have you with us. Before we begin, I would just like to acknowledge the traditional owners of country throughout Australia and their continuing connection to land, sea, and community. We pay our respects to them and their cultures and to elders past, present, and emerging. Today's session will focus on an overview of CTEPH. Our guest speaker has a great education session lined up for you, but before we get into the content, I will firstly let you know that this webinar will be recorded. So if you do find any of the content distressing or if you need to leave at any time for another reason, then please feel welcome to do so. This recording will be hosted at Lung Foundation Australia's YouTube channel and website. If you're registered to receive our communications, you will receive a link to the recording via email with your consumer newsletter this month. As always, an interactive Q&A session will be held towards the end of the webinar, so you're welcome and encouraged to submit your questions via the Q&A box. Now, that feature is available throughout the webinar, so please feel very welcome to ask as we go. I will make a note of your question and direct it to our speaker during the Q&A segment. You can also submit questions anonymously, so if there is anything that you do want to ask without identifying yourself, then that option is there for you as well. Now, I am delighted to introduce our expert speaker for today, Dr. John Feenstra. Dr. Feenstra is the lead physician at the Pulmonary Hypertension Service at the Prince Charles Hospital in Brisbane, which is the state referral centre for CTEPH in Queensland. Dr. Feenstra is also the director of pulmonary hypertension at the Wesley Hospital and the president-elect of the Pulmonary Hypertension Society of Australia and New Zealand. I will now leave you with Dr. Feenstra. If you would like to please share your screen with everyone joining us today.
Yeah. No, thank you very much for asking me to be involved this afternoon. So it's today's talks on chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, or the acronym of CTEPH, as described, to work both at Prince Charles and Wesley Hospitals, and Prince Charles is the state referral centre for CTEPH for Queensland. One of the first questions is asked is typically, you know, how does this happen from the perspective that I've been on blood thinners and why are these clots still present? This is a surgical specimen of someone who's had a CTEPH and they've undergone a pulmonary endarterectomy. So over time, the clot becomes scar tissue, and that's what you're seeing here. This is the scar tissue that one of our surgeons has removed from a patient. Both sides, this is the right lung and the left lung. So over time, it's sort of an acronym when you're thinking, this is called chronic thromboembolic disease, has actually become scar tissue. Now, my next slide is, looking at it microscopically, that you can actually still see with ultrasound guidance that there is still areas of the blood vessels that remain open. So I'll just go that. So a bit of a movie there. Again, this will get further into the talk when we talk about another treatment modality. So you can see that there's all this blockage up the top part of the blood vessel till we get through to the distal end where there is it's patent or open. Obviously, I work at Prince Charles. I'd just like to mention Professor Keith McNeil and Fiona Kermeen, my mentors. And Keith was the director of the service many years ago that brought the surgical program or pulmonary endarterectomy to the Prince Charles Hospital with him and Dr. John Dunning. I just don't have a picture of Dr. Bruce Thompson, who is our surgeon with us at the moment. So running through this afternoon, first of all, I'm just going to say what is pulmonary hypertension to begin with, then talk about what is CTEPH and looking at diagnosis and treatment. So what is pulmonary hypertension? Well, when we take blood pressure from the standard blood pressures and we talk about, maybe 120 on 80 is someone's normal blood pressure in the arm, that's coming from the left side of the heart. So in the right side of the heart, we have a very low pressure system, as you can see here, of 14 millimetres. We can do indirect measurements with regards to these pressures from a transthoracic echo, but the gold standard for looking for pressures is the right heart catheter. And as we can see here, a patient having a right heart catheter and a cath lab. So pulmonary hypertension describes a whole group of diseases that affect the blood pressure in the vessels that transport blood to and from the lungs, the pulmonary vasculature. PH, or pulmonary hypertension, has many causes that affects different types of blood vessels in the pulmonary vasculature. So as a group of pulmonary hypertension physicians, we have broken down the causes of pulmonary hypertension into five groups. I've done a talk previously for the Lung Foundation looking at group one, which is pulmonary arterial hypertension. And this is usually idiopathic or familial or heritable pulmonary hypertension and maybe associated with connective tissue diseases. Group two being the most common cause of pulmonary hypertension. And this is typically patients that have left heart disease, such as they've had problems with their left ventricle, or they may have valvular heart disease, and that causes back pressure through the lungs and causes pulmonary hypertension via that mechanism. Thirdly, the second most common cause of pulmonary hypertension is secondary to lung disease. And that's where there's been destruction of the lung themselves. If you're thinking of the classic types that we would see, would be someone who's got, you know, severe emphysema or who has developed interstitial lung disease, where there's destruction of not just the breathing sacs of the lung, but also the blood vessels. Group five is a bit of a mismatch of different diseases that we haven't been able to categorize completely. And group four is the chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, which I'll be discussing further today. So just quickly running through function of the heart. So deoxygenated blood returns from head and neck and the lower limbs going through the right ventricle and then going out into the lungs through the pulmonary arteries. Then they pick up oxygen through and then return to the left side of the heart. And then this new oxygenated blood then goes out to the body. With all forms of pulmonary hypertension, including chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, there are blockages occur in the pulmonary arteries, either the main vessels, or in the smaller, down to the capillaries. So it is a rare condition, but it is potentially fatal. The exact prevalence is unknown. We estimate cases, and I'll go through some Australian data in a minute, thinking about 80 to 40 cases per million. The fatality becomes really about if someone has quite severe pulmonary hypertension. So meaning that their average pulmonary pressure, as we said, normal is about 14. If on catheter, if it's greater than 50 millimetres of mercury, you can see someone's survival rate is as bad as some malignancies with a 20% two-year survival. The most common cause of death, unfortunately, is right ventricular failure because the heart is not meant to be under those sort of pressures for long periods of time. But out of all the pulmonary hypertension categories, we have a potential cure for patients with CTEPH, and that is surgery, which is a pulmonary endarterectomy. And I'll go through a bit of that in a later slide. So the symptoms of CTEPH are non-specific. Mostly patients will present with shortness of breath, fatigue, malaise, they're having difficulty with activities of normal living and exercise intolerance. Sometimes they'll have some chest pain, infrequently some hemoptysis or coughing up blood, and they may have had a prior history of DVT or pulmonary embolus in the past. Oops. So over time, it can be quite insidious that, you know, sometimes we see people 3 to 5 years after their first DVT or PE, and maybe it's just, you know, they're getting a bit of shortness of breath on exertion with fatigue, and sometimes patients will be diagnosed with other more common problems such as asthma. But over time, it does deteriorate where people will get chest pain, maybe they're passing out or fainting with palpitations. And unfortunately, right at the end, we can see the signs and symptoms of heart failure where we have ascites or fluid in the abdomen, and we find that people have swollen feet and they may be turning blue with their hands and feet. again, just reiterating, not all our patients that I see in our clinic have had a history of a venous thromboembolism, DVT or PE. So anywhere from 25 to 40% of patients, we've had no previous history of that they've had a blood clot. So the physiology is that patients, you know, a number of patients each year have blood clots for whatever reason, maybe for example, long haul flight. So the blood clot goes in and gets wedged in the pulmonary arteries that we can see here. And there's a more of a picture here of a fresh clot in the pulmonary artery that's been dissected open. And a great majority of patients, after they've been on blood thinners, such as, you know, warfarin, or some of the newer agents like Zolitro or Eliquis or Apixaban, you know, a great majority of patients will have complete resolution after 3 to 6 months of anticoagulation and return of everything being normal. However, there's a small group of patients, for whatever reason, as I showed you at the beginning of the talk, that this clot becomes organized and becomes scar tissue rather than dissolving. So there are some genetics involved with that, and there is some publications being generated from our colleagues in Papworth in the UK showing a number of genes being involved with for CTEPH. And it's not a, these genes aren't about the propensity of developing clots, but more so the body's ability to dissolve them once they've occurred. Other things will happen with the clot being present, they get new blood vessel generation, they have remodeling with their vasculature, meaning that because of the high pressures, they become the smaller vessels become more tight. And then they go on to develop what we call CTEPH. And again, there's another example of a surgical specimen of scar tissue that a surgeon has removed at a surgical procedure called a pulmonary endarterectomy. So how many cases are we seeing in Australia each year? This slide is courtesy of Professor Trevor Williams from the Alfred in Melbourne. So if he's presented in the past about how many clots that occur per year in Australia, you know, DVT or PE, and how much CTEPH that we should be seeing in our clinics. And we've estimated we should be seeing 4 to 19 per million each year across Australia. We'd have to say that we are seeing less than that. So we are think this is being this is a disease that is being undiagnosed in the community and other and around Australia. So after a PE, only a small, as I said, a small proportion of patients will develop this chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. But there are other patients that will completely resolve, but post-pulmonary and PE, people can still complain of symptoms or reduced activities of daily living. Also, they can develop chronic persistent thrombi, or what we call chronic thromboembolic disease, where patients haven't developed the pulmonary hypertension, which is the severe end of it, but they still have blockages there that can cause shortness of breath. So what are the risk factors for developing CTEPH? So obviously malignancy, if patients have had a history of active malignancy, obviously formation of blood clots is higher. Diabetes, obesity. If someone's had a massive pulmonary embolus at the first instance, as well as if they've had inadequate anticoagulation. If someone, for example, I saw a patient in clinic the other day that only had 2 months of anticoagulation after a large PE, and it is most likely the reason why he has developed PH, because of the inadequate amount of time that is on anticoagulation. Splenectomy is quite common. We've seen a number of patients come through clinic with CTEPH post-splenectomy. They get a more distal disease, unsure why. Oops, back on slide, sorry about that. Other non-blood group O, we can see the antiphospholipid or lupus anticoagulant. So that's a part of the lupus spectrum of diseases that we can see in patients with developing CTEPH. So how do we detect it? It's about index of suspicion. Obviously, if someone's turning up breathless to a clinic, to the GP, cardiologist, respiratory physician, if we're thinking along the lines that this patient may have pulmonary hypertension, the first tool is the echocardiogram, which is an ultrasound of the heart to measure the pressures inside the heart. So we have a look at the right ventricle and pressures. If this is elevated, part of the screening program for pulmonary hypertension is to proceed to some form of imaging, and the preferred modality is something, a nuclear scan called a VQ scan, or ventilation or perfusion scan. So if this is completely normal, it is very unlikely to someone to have CTEPH, and they go through a workup route for pulmonary arterial hypertension or the other forms of pulmonary hypertension. If this VQ scan is positive, which we can see in, we've got a normal one over here on my left of perfusion and ventilation. But if we look over here, we've got normal ventilation here, but in the films down below those top panel, we can see that there's areas where there's white chunks out of the lung where there is no blood flow occurring. And this is pretty indicative of someone who's got CTEPH with multiple areas of the lung that are involved with blockages. So if that's positive, referring to a expert pulmonary hypertension center or CTEPH expert center for further investigations. And these typically include invasive procedures with a right heart catheter to elucidate pressures, and then looking at formal imaging of these blood vessels. So the definition really comes about from the right heart catheter. So that you have to meet a certain pressure criteria and a certain resistance with pulmonary vascular resistance through the lungs. We have to see a number of areas that are involved on the VQ scan, and a patient must have 3 months of anticoagulation with warfarin or one of those newer agents for at least 3 months before we can make the final diagnosis. Here again, I've got the VQ scan showing positive changes here for CTEPH, where there's areas of lack of blood flow to different parts of the lung. And at the Prince Charles Hospital, we have the ability to do cardiac MR and pulmonary angiography. And this is an image here of a patient that we're having a look at their pulmonary vascular tree here. That's the white, that's the contrast. And we can see blood vessels going out into the lung on this. This is their left side of their lung. But then on this right side, you can see that there is no blood vessels going down to their right bottom of their right lung. And there's an acute cutoff here. So this is a patient that has got CTEPH that's affecting, you know, their right lung. So again, the right heart catheter, just those pressures again. So the right heart catheter and pulmonary angiogram get done by a couple of our colleagues at the Prince Charles Hospital, where we go in through the groin with a catheter, up through the inferior vena cava into the heart with a catheter that firstly measure the pressures in different areas of the heart, the right atrium, right ventricle, into the pulmonary arteries, and measuring of cardiac output, so we can, you know, get those measurements to define someone's CTEPH. And that also gives us prognostic information. So we can see here the different pressure waves as they go through the heart. After they've measured the pressures, and again, that's just going through those, again, those normal pressures, usually proceed to what we at Prince Charles do is typically the pulmonary angiogram. Other centres may be doing CTPAs or CT pulmonary angiograms or cardiac MR with pulmonary angiograms. But in the end, at Prince Charles, we do the gold standard pulmonary angiogram, which we can see some visualisations here. Again, looking at the tree of vasculature going up into this right upper lobe, we're looking for blockages, with the dye being in these vessels here. So for us, this is the cornerstone of us making decisions for patients. It confirms the diagnosis for occlusions and if we can see blockages or webs. And it also gives our surgeon a view of the vasculature to see if they could potentially be a surgical candidate. So the treatment pathway from 2018, when the last World Symposium was held, again, we did diagnosis, patients will need to be on lifelong anticoagulation. And importantly, the patient needs to be assessed by a team that's expert in CTEPH. So we're needing to define whether the patient could be an operable candidate. proceeding to talk to our surgeon about a pulmonary endarterectomy, or a non-operable, for maybe they might not have surgical disease or they may have other comorbidities, to look at other treatment modalities. At the Prince Charles Hospital, we obviously have a multidisciplinary approach, and I just like to highlight our, you know, our nurses involved with that. And obviously a spectrum of people that are involved with our patients, you know, particularly immunology may be involved, for example, with patients with lupus and antiphospholipid syndrome. Our surgeons and our interventionalists, balloon angioplasty, as well as everyone else here on this list. So what happens after you've had all those investigations, and particularly after the right heart cath and pulmonary angiogram, we have a weekly team meeting, multidisciplinary team meeting, with ourselves, cardiologists, the interventional radiologists, as well as our other radiologists that cover MRI and nuclear, a surgeon, anaesthetists, and nursing and allied health. So the first question is, we go back to that treatment algorithm, is the patient a surgical candidate? Because that we know that that's got the best potential for cure. And obviously Dr. Bruce Thompson is our surgeon at the Prince Charles Hospital. And if a patient is potentially borderline, he does and will and has sought second opinions from Dave McGiffin down in Melbourne, our other surgeon in Australia. Operability is assessed with the traditional approach to the VQ and angiogram. So, as I stated before, if a patient is a surgical candidate, PEA or pulmonary endarterectomy is the treatment of choice for patients for CTEPH. It is, in most cases, it is curative once all of this is removed. So there's surgeons can take out different levels of disease. You can have proximal disease, level 1 to level 4. And you can see these are just examples of different types of scar tissues and the involvement that of the lung, what they can get down to. The next slide is a short surgical film with Dr. Bruce Thompson performing a procedure. So it lasts for about 10 seconds. If you're a bit squeamish, you don't want to see any blood, very little blood actually, but just look away now. So this is him. This is the pulmonary artery has been opened and he's slowly dissecting away. You can see he's pulling away some of the scar tissue in that main pulmonary artery with a Jameson sucker as we're pulling through here. So then for the further procedure, he will go down further into those pulmonary arteries, following the scar tissue into the smaller blood vessels. Unfortunately, up to 50% of patients aren't operable. So don't go undergo PEA. So there's operable patients, you know, 86% of them will go on, 14% may not go on with an operation, maybe it's their personal choice or they've got other comorbidities or they don't wish to proceed. Whereas obviously there's the non-operable group that, you know, a number of years ago, nothing was done apart from maybe medical therapy. So after, if surgery is ruled out or pulmonary endarterectomy, we go down the non-operable route. And at Prince Charles Hospital and like other centres in Australia now, we are offering medical therapy with or without balloon pulmonary angioplasty. And that's really a new development in the last few years with the balloon pulmonary angioplasty. So in the past, you know, obviously we've discussed surgery and that's been around since the 1970s. Then there was a flurry for balloon angioplasty in the 1980s, but there was significant issues with technique and at that time. So morbidity and mortality of the procedure was quite high. But thankfully the Japanese stuck on it for a number of many years. And around 2012, there was a number of publications coming through from Japanese groups, as well as some of the European groups showing successful treatment with balloon angioplasty. And then subsequently after that, there was also a medication called riociguat, which had a positive clinical trial. And that is the only drug that's available in Australia for this condition. Had a successful publication. There's also been a couple of other studies, but we at the Prince Charles Hospital are involved with a couple of others for needing further evidence for some of these other other drugs that are that we use for pulmonary hypertension. So if patients have disease that isn't operable, then you know we look at medical therapy, or if we've had a patient that's had surgery and they have residual high pressures despite the removal of that blood clot, then we look at medical treatment. And as I said, in Australia, there's only one drug that's been approved by the PBS, and that's called Riociguat. It works on the nitrous oxide pathway, on the same pathway that we use drugs like sildenafil or Viagra for people with pulmonary arterial hypertension, because what it does is open up the blood vessels inside the lungs. So this drug also works on that pathway. And there's been short studies, which we got it initially approved, showing improvements in 6-minute walk test, and also with vascular resistance and people's functional class, meaning how breathless they are. And also there's been some, the CHEST2 study was a long-term study, again, showing ongoing good effects with this medication. If medical therapy isn't enough, as I said, we've now gone on to do a procedure called balloon pulmonary angioplasty, which has sort of helped revolutionize this area, because it, and why it works is if we have a look at the histology of those scar tissue of the blood vessels, we can see there are new blood vessels in within the scar tissue that we can see here. So this is the pulmonary artery here, and all this material inside is this like scar tissue or fibrin, but the body does work away that have these small channel or pathways. And as we showed you that video at the beginning part of the talk, this is where the ballooning can help us, or help patients, I should say. So the indications for balloon angioplasty: if someone's not eligible for surgery, or they may have ongoing pulmonary hypertension after surgery and still have more distal blockages that we can open up, or they've had inadequate response to the medical therapy such as Riociguat. So what happens with this procedure, with this again, with that diagram of the green being the scar tissue, the red being new blood vessels, is actually we can actually send a small balloon down those channels and disrupt them and open them up. And what we've learned over the last 10 years is that these vessels will stay open once they've been ballooned. So again, this is from some histology, again, showing a patient with a web or blockage up here and having subsequent opening up of the blood vessel after a balloon procedure. So we can't balloon every lesion with patients with CTEPH. We can open up ones that are ring-like, like a stenosis, that there's a blockage here that we can open up. If there's a web, or what we call a slit as well, maybe a subtotal occlusion, we can definitely get a small vessel through there. Right. These are the tougher ones, the last two. The totally occluded ones we try to avoid because there's a high complication rate. And from experience from our centre too, if someone has long-standing CTEPH for many years, they do develop these sort of more abnormal tortuous vessels, and they're more likely to rupture once we open them up. So this is from our centre, same lesions. We've got the ring light procedure up here. We've got these sort of, you know, webs. We can see these white lines across here. I'll show you some more in a minute. There's a blood vessel here at the back here with C. You've got contrast going down this vessel not nicely, but then as we can see, there's sort of a ghost of a vessel here that can be opened up. And then those more difficult or other blood vessels that we try to avoid that are completely occluded, where you can see that this is a very nodular blood vessel. So again, going through, this is why we need an expert team to have a look at it, whether or not someone is operable or non-operable, and whether or not they're a surgical candidate or do they need medical therapy with balloon angioplasty for their CTEPH. So there are some complications with the BPA. Typically, it can be some hemoptysis. Sometimes we get some patients that we do rupture a blood vessel, our rate is very low, but otherwise, you know, the mortality rate for this is a very low, less than 1%. So just some cases, what we've done over the last 3 years at Prince Charles. We've got first case here. You can see this is a lower lobe blood vessel, which is looks very ratty, and it's got these white lines through here. This is scar tissue, and it looks like there's a slit here. And then our colleagues here pass down a wire, and then there's a balloon that's been inflated. And you can see the subsequently there's improved blood flow down to the bottom parts of the lung through that vessel once they've ballooned open that blood vessel. Again, one of our first patients that went through the BPA program, I'll just go back. Again, you can see a quite tight stricture here. This is in the right upper lobe. Again, they've already passed the wire through there and they've opened that up with a balloon. And again, we can see that this has opened up nicely with return of blood flow to that part of the lung. So just some colour pictures, just showing some other patients over time have done balloon angioplasty too. Blue is where areas of lack of blood has been going through. And post procedure, where you know where there's light green, there's return of blood flow. You can see clearly that there's been improvements in flow for this patient, and their symptoms are significantly improved. Again, another patient, showing that sort of there's blood in the peripheral part of their lung, and we've opened those up with the BPA. Again, another patient just showing these sort of wedge shape areas where there's no blood getting through. But over time, with my colleagues that do the BPA, we've opened up those vessels to the lung. So it's a team effort. Put our nurses first because they do all the coordination. Kathy's now retired, but Jennifer and Kerry are our two main nurses that work within the program that coordinate all the procedures and investigations for patients and treatment. Brendan and Nick are our interventional cardiologists and radiologists that do the balloon pulmonary angioplasty and also the diagnostic catheter and angiogram. Rachel Rourke's a director of radiology that looks at all our MRIs and imaging. George Dvorsky is instrumental with helping us develop the program. He's our director of cardiology. And my boss, Professor Peter Hopkins, as well as Ian Smith, being in the anaesthetist. And obviously, finally, Bruce, our surgeon. I can't miss him. We've had away, I'd just like to acknowledge two programs that have helped develop our BPA program to bring to our CT service. My colleagues in San Diego and Paris group, both myself and Nick Brown, have been involved with them, and just acknowledge them for helping us getting us off the ground. So conclusions, really, CTEPH is an uncommon cause of pulmonary hypertension, but like other causes of pulmonary hypertension, this is potentially curable. Particularly with surgery for the pulmonary endarterectomy. Patients should be referred to a PH or CTEPH expert centre that has a multidisciplinary team to review the, particularly importantly, reviewing the imaging of the patient and working out a treatment program, be it surgical, BPA, medical, or a combination or potential combination of all three treatment modalities. Again, I reiterate, surgery is still the gold standard and is curative. We've added on BPA in our program in the last 3 years on top of the medical therapy that's available through the PBS. Importantly, for patients with CTEPH, lifelong anticoagulation is required. The recommendation from my centre and other centres around the world is still warfarin over the newer agents lifelong. That is a summary of CTEPH, and I'm happy to answer any questions through the bridge, Rosetta.
Well, on behalf of everyone joining us today, thank you very much, Dr. Feenstra, for sharing your wealth of knowledge. I think everyone with us will have taken a lot away from your very detailed and comprehensive presentation. That was brilliant. So thank you very much. And I can't tell you how much we appreciate it. Now, I can see our Q&A box has begun to light up already. So we will begin the Q&A session now. And before we begin, I will just remind you that responses to the questions today will be of a general nature only, and they might not relate to your specific case. So we do recommend you seek advice from your treating healthcare team further to any of the broader guidance that will be discussed here. So our first question for you, can I exercise if I have CTEPH? That's a good question. Thank you.
Yes. For all causes of pulmonary hypertension, exercise is still important. Part of your management, not just medical and the ballooning that, and surgery that I've discussed. Typically, that's done through a pulmonary rehab program or through your centre that has expertise with pulmonary hypertension. And we typically try to develop a program for an individual, depending on what they're up to with their disease.
Thank you very much. Okay, next question. I've finally been diagnosed with CTEPH, but I've been having symptoms for over 3 years. Is it normal for it to take so long to get a diagnosis?
Yes, it can be. I just saw a gentleman today that's had 3 years of, again, symptoms. There is, unfortunately, for pulmonary hypertension as a whole, a delay of diagnosis for up to 3 years. Again, because of the symptoms are non-specific, unfortunately. And obviously people get treated for other things or haven't, pulmonary hypertension hasn't been thought about till after several visits. So unfortunately, yes, that is still a very common occurrence that we're seeing people later in their disease rather than early.
Great, thank you very much. Okay, another question for you. This person has got scleroderma, so that's a connective tissue disease, yes. And CTEPH as well, and they're wondering if they're just very unlucky or if there is actually a connection between the two.
I think they'll be very unlucky. Typically don't see that connection. Unless they've got an underlying, with their scleroderma, they may have an underlying procoagulant state. Some patients with scleroderma may have an overlap syndrome, so they may develop a clotting tendency. So, but I haven't seen that connection and it's not in the literature.
Okay. Thank you very much. Now there's no further questions, so I'll just leave it for a few seconds. Oh, no, here we go. Someone else now has asked, is there a specific type of exercise I should do?
So we usually individualise to the patient at the Prince Charles Hospital with our physiotherapist. There are a number of different things that she will go through with the patient, but walking, exercise, bike, other programs. We do it on an individual basis.
Thank you very much. So again, back to your treating healthcare team, or you can always contact Lung Foundation's Information and Support Centre if you're needing some extra help with that as well. Mm-hmm. Now, I think that brings us to the end of the Q&A segment. So on behalf of everyone joining us today, thank you very much, Dr. Feenstra, for sharing your wealth of knowledge. I think those joining us will have a lot to take away from that. Yep. And I can't tell you how much we appreciate it. So I do hope everyone listening today was able to gain something from our session, and please do get in touch with our Information and Support Centre, as I said, via those details there on your screen if you're needing help with anything else. So that's 1-800-654-301. Now, before we sign off, I will leave you again with the details of our newly launched online peer support group for people living with PAH. So this is a group for everyone right across Australia to connect and support each other in an open and welcoming community. The name of the group is Positively Amazing Hope. So they're just in the initial stages of establishment now with our online peer support network, and they are welcoming and encouraging new members to join now. So please visit our peer support pages to learn more or to express your interest in joining. You can also contact, again, our information and support centre on 1800 654 301 if you did want to learn more or ask anything about that. So with that, I will close the session and the Live Well, Breathe Better patient webinar series for the year. Thank you again to everyone who's joined us and to those watching the recording later on as well. Please look after yourselves and each other, and we'll see you next year. Bye for now.